First of all, it's an honor to be invited in this workshop here in France. I will talk about the simplex geometry of graphs. The work has been done together with Karel De Vriend, who is doing now his PhD in Oxford. First of all, I give a background and some information on why we started on this kind of a research, and it's on electrical networks. It was inspired by power grids. I come immediately to that, and then I turn as an artifact. We found, I think, interesting things on the geometry of a graph. So let us first start with the background, and I do a fast repetition of the symbols I'm going to use. First of all, many of you know already an adjacency matrix. If you have a simple graph with six nodes and nine capital L is nine links, then you can basically represent this as an adjacency matrix. And an adjacency matrix is a 0-1 matrix. Important to notice is I only talk about adjacency matrices which are symmetric, so it's undirected. The adjacency matrix only gives you the existence of a graph. The diagonal elements are zero, so I also include self-loops. And then an important characterizer of any graph, that's the local number of nodes, that's the degree, which is the sum of the row sum of each node. The second matrix is a matrix which gives you the directions. I only use the incidence matrix for directions. And the incidence matrix is not a square matrix, but it's a matrix which has here in the rows the number of nodes. So here we have six nodes, so six rows. And there are then nine columns because there are nine links. And each of the columns represent a link. And you choose your own kind of numbering of the links. But what is important here is that the link starts in a node and it ends in another node. And then you can use the agreement that if we start, we use a plus one, and we end, we use a minus one. Okay, this is well known. This is the incidence matrix. The nice property of this matrix is that it's easy to see that all the column sums, right, add to zero. And I will use this kind as the sum over all the columns here is zero. So this is the 1-1-1 vector. And if you multiply this by the 1-1-1 vector, you see that this is the characteristic property of the incidence matrix. Okay, so important, the incidence matrix I only use to specify the directions, not the adjacency matrix. The adjacency matrix is always real, well, I mean always symmetric. And then the matrix which will play the most important role in my story is the adjacency, the Laplacian matrix. The Laplacian matrix is defined in two ways. It's defined in the way as the incidence matrix multiplied by its transpose. And if you work out that matrix here, then you find the diagonal matrix of the degree, which I actually noticed by the capital delta in Greek. So this is the vector of the degrees, which is on the diagonal, and off line in the diagonal, you have the adjacency matrix with a minus sign. Okay, this is the structure of the Laplacian matrix. And immediately from the definition here, you see that it is a symmetric matrix. So it means that in my story, both the adjacency matrix as the Laplacian matrix are only working for undirected graphs. Okay, B, the matrix B again, gives you the directions. And the basic property is, and that's a very important one, and very important one I will use and come back to that later on because it has a severe number of properties, that is that the eigenvalue equation, if you solve this, the Q has an eigenvector which is the all 1-1 vector belonging to an eigenvalue 0. Okay? And I give here then very shortly where it comes from. It's related on the incidence matrix. So that's, and I stress this property because I will overuse this again and again. And it will play a very important role, although it's a very obvious property. It also means that the inverse, or the just the inverse of the Laplacian matrix is not possible. Yeah? So now I come to network science. And in network science, I look to networks in two ways. A network always consists in an underlying topology, which is the graph. And over the graph, we have then a service. So that's a network. A network is not only the graph. A network is basically the combination of, well, in my definition, the combination of a topology, a graph, a hardware, if you wish, and then a function for which we are going to use the graph. And the function, in most of the cases, can be a service, and it gives a reflection of, in most cases, a transport from a node A to a node B over the physical infrastructure, which is the hardware. In many cases, most of the study in network science, which is roughly 20 years old, has been concentrated on the topology. So a lot of results are known on the topology, and only quite little or few results are known on the service and the function. So it's fair to say that the service and the function is way more complex to handle and to get nice results than on the topology and the graph. Also because the topology and the graph is probably much more specified, while the service and the functions on the graph are way more complex. That's what I say here. In any graph, you basically have two separations what you can make. You can have a transport, which is a flow, like think about very simple, it's just water flowing through a network. Or you can have a packetized, which is a discrete unit, like for instance an IP packet or a postal letter or a car or a container. And these separations are governed, first of all, the flow equations are governed in most of the cases by the laws of nature. So humans do not play a role. Because if you concentrate on waters, for instance, water is flowing from a high height to a lower height over the tubes, and that is governed by nature. So humans or what we want to do, we don't have anything to define, because physics defines the laws, how the transport is going from A to B. And probably I'm going actually to focus on this kind of equations, because again, they are much more simpler than the equations which are protocol equations. In protocol equations, we have actually a human standardization, and then we say, okay, we want to have a transport from an IP packet from A to B, and then we have a set of rules how we are going to do it. It's not always the shortest path, but it might deviate from the path according to what we humans agree with each other. You have autonomous domains, and it can be quite complicated. Another thing is that here the protocols have mainly been designed to ignore the underlying topology. And that's a very strange thing, because 20 years ago we have actually, or even longer, we have designed protocols and rules in order to be ignorant of the underlying protocol, the underlying network or the graph, the hardware. In other words, we've designed protocols that work over all possible network or infrastructures, right? And this is actually a quite deep engineering thing, because if you remember, there are two major companies that have followed either the coupling of the service and the graph, and one is, I would say, Apple, the other is Microsoft. Microsoft has basically focused on only the services and has defined an operating system which is actually ignorant to some extent of the underlying transistor network, right? And they defined designed an operating system that should run over all possible, in principle, all possible hardware infrastructures or transistor networks. While Apple has chosen more the reason that, okay, we would like to have a performant infrastructure where we have the coupling of the function and the underlying topology. And more people are thinking then, if you go to optimizations, you think, okay, you optimize the system, you should take the two layers into account. And also inspired by nature, our brains is a coupling of the two layers very strongly to each other, even to the extent that nature has an adaptive network which is changing over time in order to make the functions better. Okay, so this is the introduction. I'm now going to focus on the simplest thing that I can do. And the simplest thing is that I look to the transport which is given by flow equation and which is even linear, what I call, or proportional in the underlying graph. And you know all these things. Linear dynamics on networks are very basic and given actually in high school in most of the cases. What I mean by a linear dynamic which is proportional to the graph, that's just as following. You have two nodes in the graph, I and J. You say that there is a flow, and whatever the flow can be, it can be an electrical current or it can be water, whatever it is. The flow is injected at a node I and it leaves here the node J. It flows over a link in my network, and the flow or the magnitude of the flow is proportional to the voltage difference between the two points. That's well known. Everybody knows this. So examples are displacements in the spring, heat, and I will focus a little bit in the language of electrical currents, yeah, voltage relations. So what we have actually, it is proportional. So it means that we have an injected current vector here. All these current in each node, you can actually inject a current. So the whole vector, which has as components the individual nodes here, the injected nodal current is proportional to the voltage vector here. And the proportionality vector is the Laplacian. And that you can easily derive. So, and that's the starting equation where we started with. If you have this kind of an equation, which you can easily derive from conservation of law, Kirchhoff laws, and the law of Ohm, yeah, you say that actually the current is flowing and the resistance, yeah, we only look to resistances, although you can also exaggerate, well, extend this to impedances like inductors and capacitors, but okay, that's a little bit more complex, but still it's linear and you can do it. But here for the settings, I just assume that you have a kind of a resistance. Each link has its own positive resistance, which is actually a link weight. Yeah? And then you come up with these equations. If you have this equation, you assume, of course, that the nodal potential is known, and if the known, and if also the structure of the underlying graph is known, and all these resistances, then you can compute the nodal current. Okay, that is our starting point. An interesting thing is, if you have this kind of a linear equation and you have only the voltage vector, you can compute the injection of currents, but we also want to have the inverse. Yeah. So
inverse is not possible. You say that.
No, I come to that. Very good question. But we've the basic thing is, you can perfectly invert the system, but you need to have one condition more. The equation that we've derived basically, I didn't derive them, but you all agree that it's correct, that the injected current vector is proportional to the voltage vector. And then this is what I call the current voltage relation. And you can invert that equation. The inversion is not so easy as just having the inverse of your matrix, because the inverse of the matrix doesn't exist. But we use the pseudo inverse. And the pseudo inverse is actually denoted by Q to the power, with here a Dekkert. Yeah, this is what I call a pseudo-inverse. And if you do and you use the pseudo-inverse, I will immediately say what I mean by the pseudo-inverse and how I define it. Then you have actually a quite of symmetric equations. And these are very nice. Yeah? It's precisely as if the inverse exists. There is, of course, one constraint. The first is the constraint that the sum of the currents which I inject in my network is zero, and that's a conservation law. Oh yeah, this is U transpose is the sum over all components. Yeah, that's a short notation, which is a little bit interesting. And the thing is, if you use now here this notation, you need to actually specify something about the voltage, because you know that the voltage is only the voltage differences. And by the fact that you use voltage differences, yeah, and your Laplacian is zero, you have one equation, you lack one equation, because the rank of your system is one less, because that's actually the connotation of having not a determinant, or the determinant is zero. So you add one equation and you say that the average potential is also zero. So you say that the average of all the potential here, this one, right, all the potentials here, the average is zero. And that's the only thing. If you do that in a consistent way, you can then use and invert these equations. And we come to the spectral decomposition. Actually, we came to the spectral decomposition. You can write any weighted Laplacian here. I used actually an old notation for a weighted Laplacian, while this is not weighted, but anyway. This is a positive summative matrix, and the smallest eigenvalue, mu sub capital N, is zero, so it's not in the sum here. So I actually sum over N minus one eigenvalues, and here orthogonal spaces, which are governed by the outer product of my eigenvectors zk that's belonging to mu k. And so then the pseudo inverse is, or is the same as the more Penrose inverse, is just the same equation in which we now invert the eigenvalues 1 over, and then you have the pseudo inverse. And if you use that, then you're fine again, you can compute everything. And by the way, it goes very fast, because in MATLAB, for instance, if you use these computations, MATLAB has a function, and everything works. So you can invert these kind of equations. Nice, of course, if you look to power grids or to networks, there is the notion of effective Kraft resistance, you know, the effective resistance, which means that if you inject a unit current in some node and it leaves the network in another node, you want to know actually that what is now the effective resistance, because the current is actually flowing over all possible paths from A to B, right? And in order to compute all these resistances, you can actually define the effective resistance. I'm not going to specify this. I will need the effective resistance. You can write it in a matrix, and that's the matrix, which is a bit a complicated structure, so to say. Here you have the pseudo inverse of our Laplacian, and then here you have the diagonal elements of the pseudo inverse. And these diagonal elements of the pseudo inverse have a very deep fundamental meaning, which is related to the degree vector of a graph. And then what often also occurs is, in order to compare graphs from the flow nature, we compare them by focusing on the effective graph resistance. So the higher the effective graph resistance is for a graph, the worse the graph is in order to transport items from or flows from A to B, right? So the lower it is, and the complete graph, well, if you have all unit resistance, the complete graph has the lowest effective graph resistance equals to n minus 1. Okay, this is the introduction, this is the setting, this is actually the motivation why we started with Laplacian first and the pseudo-Laplacian. Okay. Now I come, I give still the motivation, because a lot of people here, like Facebook and so on, are more interested in not in electrical currents, but in social networks. And here you see a nice application of electrical theory in social networks. Suppose now you inject a current here in the node I, and in all the other nodes you have an equal part where the flow leaves. Okay, so I choose a node I in which I inject a current, a unit current for instance, and in all the other nodes the current flows equally out. Yeah? In an electrical setting, that's not an interesting problem. In a social network, it's a much better problem. You just replace current by information, and you're looking for the person in the network that is the best spreader, actually. Because you want, actually, to inject here a current in a person which spreads in a most effective way his information to all the neighbors in his social network. And that is what we are going to solve with our elegant, simple equations. Again, you have these pair of inverses, and the only thing what I now need to stress again, we choose the voltage reference, which is the average sum of the degree, the average sum of the potential is zero. And then, now if you now use this injected current here, it means in one node I inject, and this is the basic vector EI, meaning all elements are zero except the element, the component I, which is one, and then in all the other nodes, I have 1 over n, one of the flow is leaving. And again, the u is the 1-1-1 vector. The nice thing is, if you plot this, or you substitute this equation into our voltage equation, and since u is an eigenvector belonging to the eigenvalue 0 of this matrix, so it disappears, it has a very easy notation, namely that the voltage on the point A here, the voltage what we are actually looking for, right, is nothing else than the diagonal element of the pseudo-inverse of the Laplacian. And the meaning is quite simple. If you want to inject a current, you're going to search for the node which has the lowest potential, because that's actually, potential is related to energy. Your effort in order to distribute information in a network is optimized if you use this kind of a setting. Okay, this is an idealized setting in which I assumed that each of the nodes has an equal amount of current, and then it's it's nice. This is a simplified version. By the way, we've used this as a kind of a graph metric, yeah, in order to attack networks. And you can attack networks in the sense that taking out nodes one by one in order to break down the network in the fastest way. And in a comparison with more than 50 real-world infrastructures, we found that the node between us is a little bit better. And then on the second position, this one is over the closeness, over all other metrics what we have tried to find. Okay, this is a kind of a motivation why I believe that this metric or the diagonal elements of the pseudo-inverse have an interesting graph theoretical meaning. And I will now emphasize this a little bit better if we go to the geometry of a graph. Okay, so now I end my first part. This was probably quite fast. This was the background, why we were interested actually to study electrical equations. And now by studying these equations, the electrical equations, we came up or we discovered basically that you can represent any undirected graph in three ways. Actually, the most useful way is you can use it in topology domain. So most of the papers have been actually, and then I'm talking about more than 90% of the papers on graphs are in this domain, the topology domain. Yeah, people like to see the nodal link domain, and the representation can be the adjacency matrix or a linked list or whatever, right? So this is the representation in which most of the research has been done. The other representation, the spectral domain, and again, I assume that the adjacency matrix is symmetric, then you have a nice eigenvalue decomposition. And here I use the X as being the orthogonal eigenvector matrix, which in the columns you have the eigenvectors. And the lambda, capital lambda here, is the diagonal element, the diagonal matrix with in the diagonal, on the diagonals, the eigenvalues of the adjacency matrix. Right, so these are the two most used ways. And then we also discovered that any graph can be represented by a simplex in the n minus one, in the n dimensional, it should be n minus one dimensional space, right? Because I have n nodes and it should be one dimension low. So this is a kind of an error. This is quite new work, what is still not published, but we put it on the archive. And here I use the simplex in a way, I use the simplex in an other way than Sergei did in simplicious complexes. Yeah? I will immediately find what I define as a simplex. So, but now it's fair to say around February, we discovered a book by Miros Fiedler, which is an absolute great person. He has devoted more than 50 years in algebra. And he wrote a book on matrices and graphs in geometry, and it was only appeared in 2011, but last year we found it. And in that book, we saw a lot of insights, what we also discovered independently of Fiedler. But it's fair to say he was first, and some of his terminology I'm now going to use to introduce the setting. And then I will say a little bit where we have extended the work of Fiedler. First of all, what is a simplex? Well, a simplex is a very simple thing. It's basically a generalization of a triangle in any dimension. And that's important. So most of the figures I will show are, well, in a 2D, a triangle. And then, yeah, I can't go further. That's a tetrahedron, right? And that immediately gives you the weakness of our representation. I'm limited by the dimensionality. So normally a graph has n nodes and I need to represent them in the n minus one dimensional space. And I don't know how I can visualize this. But anyway, mathematics will help us a bit. The one thing what is a strong point is that Euclidean geometry is the oldest mathematical discipline. And we are going to use a little bit of these principles in order to characterize or tell something about a graph. And again, we start with our Laplacian, because that's how we also started and discovered this. You start with the spectral decomposition of the Laplacian. Yeah, these are the eigenvectors again in the columns. And in the diagonal, you have the eigenvalues, which I write as mu1, which is larger than mu2, and so on. And the smallest one is mu sub n, which is 0, right? Because that's the crucial thing, and that will come over and over again. The fact that you have here an eigenvalue which we know, and an eigenvector which we completely know. So, because this equation holds, which is actually an eigenvalue equation. Now, if you write this matrix, then I write it also in two ways. This is the way what most of the people know. All the eigenvectors are, well, for a symmetric matrix, all the eigenvalues are orthogonal. Yeah? So if you take the scalar product of any eigenvector with itself, it's 1, and with all the others, it's 0. So this is the well-known kind of orthogonality relation, what everybody knows. But a much deeper one, which I find strange, is that also the orthogonality, so it means, and if you take this as vector, so I write here the Z matrix, the orthogonal matrix, and here all the components of the eigenvalue, the eigenvector belonging to the eigenvalue 1, that's Z1, Z2, and so on, and the columns. Then if you take the scalar product between that vector and that vector, then you end up with, 0, or with itself it's 1. But the nicest thing is what I call actually double orthogonality, that the same holds if you actually take it in the row vector. If you take this in a row vector and you take the scalar product with itself, then it's also 0. Yeah? And that's a little bit more what it physically means. It's a little bit harder, because here we can say that this is related in this column with the eigenfrequencies or the eigenvalues, while in this column we tell something about the nodus. So if you look in this row, you can say that always node 2. Node 2 is specified by a property on several frequencies. Okay? That's how you can actually look to this way. And that's the orthogonality condition if you look to the nodal frequencies. Or to the nodus itself over all the frequencies, sorry. And then this matrix we know, because that's actually the UUU matrix. If you then normalize it, it's 1 over square root n. So the whole, or for any, and even weighted Laplacian, obeys this kind of general equations. All the eigenvalues are real and positive. The smallest one is 0. And here you see that then the eigenvector belonging to the smallest one is normalized 1 over square root n. So this is known. And from that equation, you can actually write then the more vectorial equation as the sum over all the eigenvalues, and here then the outer product of these eigenvectors. Okay. And now, only for a positive semidimetric matrix, we can do another factorization. Yeah? Because all the diagonal elements here, the eigenvalues, are positive. So you can take actually the square root of a positive number. By the way, in the adjacency matrix, you know with probability 1, well, there must be always a negative because the trace is 0, because all the diagonals are 0, so there must be a negative eigenvalue, and then you cannot use this, because then the square root of a negative eigenvalue is not a real number, okay? So, but here you can do it. And so it perfectly makes sense to write or separate this matrix in two parts. And now if you define now the S matrix as the transpose of this one, then you see that we can write any weighted Laplacian in the form of an S matrix transpose S. Yeah? And that's a Gram matrix. That's also known in linear algebra. It's a Gram matrix. And we know that because the eigenvalue is the smallest eigenvalue is 0, the rank of that matrix is n minus 1. Okay, so if you now write the S matrix, yeah, so you have to multiply now the eigenvectors with the square of the eigenvalues, and this is not a difficult exercise, then you see here that this is node 1, this is node 2, node n, okay? I rewrite this matrix here. And the column here, what I said here, the column I, can be represented by a vector. You can write this matrix in a vector notation. And this vector is nothing else than what I wrote here in green, right? And this vector, you can always represent that as a point in the n minus one dimensional space. Yeah? So all these vectors here, you start writing or drawing in the n dimensional space. How? Here the space is only two. Yeah? And then you can find that if you connect these endpoints, you see a kind of a triangle, which we call a simplex. And from now on, if I go now more to the geometry, I erase the fact that these are all zero. Yeah? So I lose basically a dimension, one. So I scratch out the zero and I only concentrate now on the S matrix, which is actually S minus one, right? It has one row less. And that is the matrix which will define the points of my simplex. And then we could prove actually that at simplex, that the connection between this point is a simplex. However, it's fair to say that Fiedler was before us and he discovered this already. So substantially, it means that so far any undirected graph can be represented by a simplex. And the simplex can be represented by vertices and edges. And now I use really the geometric meaning. I talk in the graph about nodes and links. And here in the geometric representation, I talk about an edge and a vertex. Of course, the vertices are one-to-one coupled to the nodes. The edges are not. Okay? And you can also talk about a face. Yeah? So of this tetrahedron, one of the faces is a triangle, and you can actually denote a face by the elements on which it is defined. So, and then we will use, and here we follow Fiedler, we will use barycentric coordinates. Probably he invented this. Barus in Greek is heavy, so it means these are coordinates which are related with the center of the existence of the simplex. And then you can say that the face, so this face, is basically the collection of points in the n minus one dimensional space that are generated by the S matrix, which depends of our Laplacian. And then you use here then a coordinate, and this is a barycentric coordinate, which is a real number, and the real number is positive, well, it's a real number, and it's only non-negative if the node I belongs to the face here, which I have, or the set capital V, and the set capital V defines basically the face F sub V. Probably this is a bit more involved, but that is what we will use to represent the points. And I give here now a couple of examples. First of all, I talk about the centroids, and the centroid is defined as now a simple barycentric coordinate, which is either one or zero, and divided by the total number of components here, because the condition is that it should lie on the edges or on the edges of our simplex. Okay, this is a vector, yeah. And we call it a centroid vector of a face. And this terminology is borrowed from Fiedler. Okay, this is not ours. What is now the centroid of the simplex? If you now say that this is the UUU, the 111 vector for all of them, then you see that it's zero. So the centroid of, well, the centroid of our simplex is just the origin. And that's nice. So we take this as the origin, and all the other vectors, the S vectors, are pointing from the origin to the edges of the simplex. Another thing which is, I find cool, but rather straightforward, you can use complementary faces, meaning that a face is basically governed by all the ones that belong to the face, and the complement is, and I write here the complement as V with a bar, that's the complement of them. This is just this kind of an easy definition of complement, but if you fill it in the centroid, and again reminding that the 111 vector is an eigenvector of the S vector, so it disappears, then you see that the centroid here, or the centroid of a certain face, is just pointing in the opposite direction as that of the complementary face. In a triangle, you see it like this. You know? If you have here now the centroid, you say the centroid is here, and this, the factor C2 is pointing in this direction, and the complement is pointing in the other direction. Yeah? So, and this is nothing else than the well-known property that the middle lines of a triangle are all going to the center. Yeah? They are all crossing in one point, and the point here is our centroid. So that's an other way of looking to a geometric property on triangles, and which you can actually extend to any faces in the simplex. Okay, let me now come to the geometric representation of a graph, because this was a little bit introduction in how you represent the centroid and barycentric coordinates. It's a bit complex, I know, for the first time, but anyway. So I'm now going again to use the spectral decomposition of the Laplacian. And now I write this as these vectors Si. Yeah, and the scalar product from Si over Sg, you can work it out, is nothing else than the element of my Laplacian. Okay. This means that if I have the scalar product, I can also find the norms. Yeah? You can compute them, but in the figure it's more easy. If you now see again the triangle, you have the barycentric, well, the centroid, which is the origin, and each of these edges is a vector S1 and S2. Then you see that the length of S1 is nothing else than the degree. Yeah? That's nice, because that has a physical representation of the graph. So the length of this vector is the degree. And you can also think about what is the scalar product, or the angle, yeah, between those points. And if you take the scalar product, it is nothing else than the element 1, 2 in my Laplacian, and that is the negative of the element in my adjacency matrix. In other words, if there is a link between the node 1 and node 2, then it's a 1, right? And it's minus, so the cosine is larger than 90 degrees, yeah? So it's larger than 90 degrees. If it is 0, if there is not a link, then these vectors are orthogonal. It's cool, eh? Well, I find that cool. So you can make a representation in the simplex, and just by seeing whether there is a link between 1 and node 2, the edge here, these are orthogonal vectors. And then you can also say that the distance between this 2 points, that distance you can work it out. And since the distance is actually defined, yeah, based on the decomposition again of our Laplacian, yeah, the matrix with all those elements here, the matrix is a distance matrix. And a distance matrix is a matrix in which all the elements are positive. The diagonal elements are zero, because the distance to yourself is zero. And each of those elements obeys, and that's more important, obeys the triangle inequality. And that's by no means a very simple thing. But this is guaranteed by the construction of the representation here of a graph. So in a nutshell, coming back, each of the nodes are the vertices of my simplex. I choose the origin to represent my vectors, and they are represented by the vectors S1 and S2. The angle between those is only orthogonal if there is not a link between the node 1 and node 2, and it is larger than 90 degrees if there is a link between 1 and 2. And then the distances, or the distance from the origin to the vertex itself, is nothing else than, or the distance squared, basically, I should be rigorous, squared is just the degree of our vector. Now I'm going to the dual representation, because I started with saying that I like the Laplacian, but also equally much the pseudo inverse of the Laplacian. Okay, you can just do the same principle and the same kind of computation. You start with the spectral decomposition of the Laplacian, the pseudo Laplacian. The pseudo Laplacian has here diagonal elements which are 1 over the eigenvalues. But the important thing is they are all positive, so I can take again here the square root. So the square root has a meaning. I can define this as a vector now, which I call S with a dagger, because it refers to the pseudo inverse. And I can have again this kind of representation, which means that the pseudo-inverse of the Laplacian can be written as a Gram matrix. Yeah? And in the Gram matrix, what is now nice is that each of the columns here again represents a vector, which I can just treat as, in the normal case, a vector in the n-dimensional space. And now the nice thing is that the distance between those vectors is nothing else than the effective graph resistance. So that's the meaning why I stressed in the beginning the effective graph resistance has a meaning, yeah, and it's also a geometric meaning. Okay, now what is the relation between, because I call this the dual representation of a graph. Yeah? So what is the relation? We use here the pseudo-inverse relation. So if you have a matrix, the transpose and multiply by the here the pseudo-inverse, then it's the identity matrix minus here a matrix which is given by the 1-1-1 vector. This is just a matrix with all ones divided by n. And if you write that in vector notation, you have, if g and I are not the same, it is minus 1 over n. If g, here the indexes are the same, it's 1 minus this 1 minus 1 over n. Why do I need that equation? If I take this equation and I take here two different values of the g, k and g here, the transpose multiply by this vector, then it's 0. And this is the construction I'm going to use to represent the dual simplex of my original graph. So the original graph is here represented by its simplex in black. Yeah? This is vertex 1, vertex 2, vertex 3. And now the inverse simplex I'm going to to construct in red. I use this kind of a definition, which means that if I take here between vector S2 and S3, which are pointing here and here, I take the difference, yeah, the difference vector, this one, yeah, which is the vector which is, well, parallel with this vector, then our new vector of the dual representation is orthogonal on that one. And if you do the calculation quite well, the difference is just on the opposite direction. So if you have now each edge here, or a face in general, and you construct perpendicular on the face a vector which is going through the origin, then that vector gives me the first component or edge of my dual representation. And you do the same with the other edge, and then you find that this red triangle is an equivalent dual representation of my graph. Nice is if you have if you have simplices, you can compute the volume. We also computed the volume, and then you can show after a lengthy calculation that the volume of the simplex is related to the square root of xi, and here some numbers which are related with n before. And the interesting thing is that xi here is nothing else than the weighted number of spanning trees. So the more spanning trees you have in your graph, the larger the volume. So the simplex with the largest volume is then just the complete graph. You can also compute the inverse of the simplex. And the inverse of the simplex is this kind of representation. And here you see that the square root of the xi here is in the denominator. And if we take the relation between both, we see that the volume of the simplex and of the dual representation is nothing else than the product over all the eigenvalues of the Laplacian. And this is n times the number of spanning trees. So actually the previous figure here, I should have drawn in scale and much, much smaller, right? Because it's a very small graph. If this is the volume which is actually the surface here, or the area of this triangle, should obey this kind of inverse relation. And then, yeah, I will skip the Steiner ellipsoids. If you have a triangle, you can always find an ellipsoid which is going through the points, the edges here of our simplex. You can also compute the volume and see that that volume is also related with or proportional with the product of the eigenvalues of the Laplacian. Now the altitude in a simplex. The altitude in a simplex, if you start with the inverse simplex, then there is a very nice result due to Fiedler that says that if you take the altitude from the vertex 2 to the base here, which is, these are basically the complementary face, and it's orthogonal, right? This altitude is given by 1 over the degree. And that's a result which we should quote, a result due to Fiedler. And we are going to generalize that result. But Fiedler did not define the inverse representation, he just was focusing on simplexes. We always take the dual approach. You have the original simplex and the dual representation. And if you now go to the dual representation, so this is now, this is an inverse simplex. Dual means that we concentrate here on the simplex. We also define here the altitude, and you can say that the altitude of this point is now nothing else than 1 over, and then you should take the dual of the degree, which is the diagonal element of the pseudo-inverse. Okay, so this, in the normal simplex, the altitude is 1 over the element of our pseudo-inverse. And recall again, that was nothing else than our best spreader. So it means that from a geometric point of view, that element, the pseudo-inverse, which I gave a simple notation as being the best spreader, has a more fundamental and deeper equation. Namely, it is in a graph just nothing else than the altitude from a point to the complementary face. Okay, and this slide might be a little bit more complicated, but here we extended the idea of Fiedler from the height, the altitude, basically to a much more general setting. And the setting is complementary sets. And complementary sets are very important in spreading processes, right? If you have an epidemic process and you have the red nodes which are infected, then those nodes can only infect the white nodes through the links which are connected by them, right? So if there is a link which has at one side a red node and at the other side a white node, this number of links is proportional, or is, you know, directly proportional to the strength of the spreading of an epidemic. Okay? And so that was actually one of the reasons why we looked at that. So the cut size, which is the number of links between the infected and the non-infected node, can again be written in terms of the Laplacian. And we use now this decomposition of the Laplacian as a Gram matrix. And if you do the whole computation, you just follow it in, then you find here that the number of links is proportional to the square of the centroid, and here a factor which is well related with the dimension of that, or the defining number of edges in my face here. So to be a little bit more concrete, if you have now here a tetrahedron, and you say that the centroid, yeah, which is determined by two edges here, or two vertices, 3 and 4, the complementary one are 1 and 3, right? And so the number of links, if you in this, the number of links between these two sets, the set 3 and 4, right, is just given by the centroid square by this equation. And that kind of a setting, this is in the normal simplex, you can actually extend also to the dual representation. And then you just substitute here the Laplacian by the pseudo-Laplacian. And then you need to fix from centroids to altitudes. And then you basically have this kind of result, that the altitude in the inverse simplex here is related to 1 over the cut set in the Laplacian, in the pseudo-Laplacian here. I agree, it's a bit more difficult. So, and the altitude is here the vector which is orthogonal to this face and that face. So it's orthogonal both to that edge between 3 and 4 and 1 and 3. And this is a kind of a generalization what we found related to Fiedler's property that the altitude is 1 over the degree of a vector, one of the degree of the the simplex. And then just to finalize, we found, and this is continuous work, that you can define metrics in an underlying graph. And I showed already these two, mainly that if you take the square root here, then, well, I should not take the square. If you take this distance between the inverse and the inverse representation, then it's the square root of our effective graph resistance. And this is just a property of the fact that the Euclidean distance between vertices in the inverse simplex have this kind of a property. And it means that all the vertices of an graph, which according to the embedding of S dagger here, obey this square root of the effective resistance. And this is again a metric, and it obeys the triangular inequality. You can also see that the square here, which is just effective graph resistance, is a metric. And in order to prove that, that's a little bit more complex, and it means that the inverse simplex of a graph, that only is possible if the weights on all the links are positive. Yeah? And of course that the angles of this one is hyperacute. So that's an equivalent representation. My final slide is a generalization of metrics, because I showed already that if the pseudo-inverse, the pseudo-inverse of the Laplacian can be written as a Gram matrix, I showed that, you can always do that, and so it determines basically a metric. And then you can generalize the whole thing, and you can say that if you define here now a metric of a function of the Laplacian, and if the function of the Laplacian is also Laplacian, because this is the basic requirement, it should be a Laplacian, then you can write this kind of an equation and saying that there is a metric between node I and node 1, node I and G, sorry. And as an example, I gave you one which we found just by curiosity, and this is one given by statistical physics. You can actually use statistical physics on metrics on a graph, and you can define here the thing what we spend a little while, we spend some time in showing that the function here of the Laplacian, and we choose here the function of the Laplacian, and this is the Laplacian, and we show that this is the Laplacian, this is the Laplacian of the complete graph, this is the Laplacian of the complete graph, but this total expression, which is a function of Q, which is a function of the Laplacian, we've shown that this is also Laplacian. And if it is a Laplacian, then this defines basically a metric. And if you write it out, you can actually use this kind of a representation, which is very related to statistical physics. If you use here the G equals minus one, you have the Bose-Einstein representation and so on. Okay, this is just for fun. I don't know what it means, but you can deduce this thing. And you can define basically that this is a metric on the underlying graph. Okay, summary. I started with using a very, very simple process, which gave linearity between the injected current and the potentials. And by having then the reverse, we came to the pseudo-Laplacian. And then if you do the spectral decomposition of the weighted Laplacian or its pseudo-inverse, you can actually represent any undirected graph in a simplex and its dual notation, which have nice, well, I believe, nice properties in the Euclidean space. And it's a kind of a geometry which, by the way, is exact. It's not an embedding. In an embedding, you always lose information, but this is exact. And one of the focal questions is still, which kind, if you see the three representations of a graph, you have the topology domain, you have the spectral domain, and now the geometric domain. I'm now looking to problems that I can solve most elegantly in the geometric domain, because that's actually the way why you use these kind of representations. Okay, this ends my talk. Thank you.
So, very interesting. So your representation using this say spectral decomposition. But when you look it the other way around, it's clear that these Z vectors provide a complete basis for all functions that you can define on the neck, okay?
Yeah.
So the question is, when you restrict to a face, does this provide are the vectors, the network, the representation that you get, does it provide a complete representation of a function that you can define on that face?
Only on the face, yes. Because you can take out one of those vectors. What is nice, if you take out on the simplex one vertex, you have again a simplex on the lower dimension, and without one node.
And that provides a complete representation for all things.
Yeah, but you have to recompute this a bit, because your orthogonality conditions are not with one less. You need to recalculate something. It's not only taking it out.